Thank you, everyone that's joined so far. We're going to give it a couple more minutes, and then we'll get started. So if you can bear with us a couple more minutes, that would be appreciated.
Buenas noches, estamos por comenzar. Vamos a dar unos minutos más para dar tiempo a que se unan más personas. Y en un minutito comenzamos. Gracias.
All right, we're going to go ahead and get started, and just wanted to say good evening, interested parties, and welcome to the second and final community workshop for the sixth cycle house element update. If everyone could keep your mic muted during the presentation, that'd be appreciated. There will be opportunity to speak after the presentation. So just to kind of let everyone know, I am D'Artagnan Johnson with the City of Fontana, and I am serving as the project manager for the sixth cycle housing element update. Assisting me with the update are Cecily Session-Goins and Fernando Herrera, and of course our consultants, Dave Barquist and Molly Mendoza with Kimberly Horn. And as most of you know, the City of Fontana was given a very high RENA number of approximately 17,000 units plus. That we have to accommodate along with that, there are many new laws that the city has to address in our draft housing element update. With that, I'm gonna be turning it over to Dave Barquist, who will give an overview of the draft housing element document. There will be opportunity, as I mentioned, later in the presentation to kind of ask questions and get feedback. But thank you for those of you that have joined us thus far, and I'm sure we'll have some more join us throughout the presentation. So, with that, I'm going to turn it over to you, Dave.
Great, and I think I'm going to turn it over to Molly, who's going to introduce us before we do a breakout session. So yeah. I'll pass it on to Molly for just a moment.
Thanks, Dave. And can you go to the next slide with our agenda? Perfect. So welcome everyone to tonight's workshop. Thank you so much for taking some time to join us and to talk about the housing element update. As D'Artagnan mentioned, this is the second workshop for this update process. I'm going to pause here and let Rosina translate in case we have any Spanish participants.
Así, buenas noches. Nuevamente, bienvenidos. Estamos por comenzar esta la que es nuestra segunda reunión, el del taller comunitario, como mencionó D'Artagnan. Estamos haciendo la introducción en inglés. Vamos a comenzar. Vamos a revisar la agenda esta noche. Bienvenidos.
Thank you, Rosina. So tonight we planned for both English and Spanish participation. So at the top of the agenda, you'll see the Spanish breakout room. So we'll be doing that in just a moment. In our respective breakout sessions, we will walk through a quick recap or an overview of the housing element, what that looks like. If you are here for workshop number one, it's a refresher. We'll also go over project status to date and outreach status to date. I'll pause, and Rosina, you can go ahead and translate that.
Sí, como pueden ver, la presentación de esta noche se dará en ambos idiomas, se va a dar en inglés y se va a dar en español. En unos momentos les vamos a dar instrucciones de cómo pueden unirse a nuestra sala en español. Vamos a hacer a revisar varios aspectos. Vamos a hacer una revisión de la reunión anterior. Vamos a hablar también sobre los diferentes temas, como va a ser una descripción general del elemento de vivienda y otros aspectos. Como les mencionamos, les vamos a dar instrucción de cómo unirse a la sala en español más adelante. Gracias.
Great. We'll talk about the RENA and the draft documents, and we'll walk through some of those components with everyone tonight. And as Zaitanyan mentioned, we have some time for community questions and answers. So definitely some time for you to come off mute and participate with everyone tonight. We'd love to have your input. So very excited for this. So we can go ahead and go to the next slide. Oh, I'm sorry, Rosina.
Sí, perdón. Vamos a también hablar esta noche sobre la adaptación del RENA. También, como mencionó Daitana anteriormente, va a haber una oportunidad para que hagan sus preguntas y se les darán respuestas. Eso va a ser más adelante, al final de la reunión, se les va a dar tiempo para que lo hagan. Gracias. Thank you, Molly.
Great, and we'll go to the next slide. Awesome. So now we're going to go ahead and open up our breakout rooms so we can go to the next slide, Dave.
Vamos ahora a abrir la sala en español.
Great. So the process is what we're going to do is we're going to open up a room. It will say Espanol. When I open up this room, it will appear on your screen. If you'd like to participate in Spanish, we ask that you just click join and you will go ahead and join us in that Spanish breakout room.
En unos momentos les aparecerá en su pantalla un cuadro como el que pueden ver ahorita. Si oprimen o si hacen clic en la palabra español y después en la palabra join, les llevará a la sala donde se va a dar la presentación en español.
Great. So I've gone ahead and opened all those rooms. And so you may get a notification that looks like the one that you see on the screen. Or Dave, if you go to the next slide. It may also look like this.
Ya sea que se va a ver un cuadro donde pueden oprimir la palabra, hacer clic en la palabra español, también puede que aparezca una nube en la parte inferior de su pantalla. Pueden también hacer clic ahí y los llevará a la sala de la reunión.
Okay, great.
Y ya están abiertas las salas.
And if you're participating in English, just go ahead and stay put. You do not need to join the breakout room. You'll remain where you are and Dave will walk you through the same exact presentation, just in English. Rosina, go ahead.
Si están, quieren escuchar la presentación en inglés, no tienen que hacer nada, solamente esperen unos minutos y la presentación comenzará, se va a dar en inglés, que es una copia exacta de la presentación que se va a dar en español. Thank you.
Thank you, Rosina. Okay, so Rosina, if you want to go ahead and join that breakout room. Perfect. All right, Dave, I'm going to head out to the breakout room. So I will pass it over to Dave Barquist and he will walk everyone here through the presentation.
Thank you, folks. I just unmuted myself, so it's a pleasure to be speaking with you this evening. Looks like we have a few folks here, some faces on the screen, but we'd like to walk you through the presentation. And for those who are not have not participated in the past, or those who have participated, you may have some repetitive information. So we'll go through it as efficiently as we can. The point that we want to get across this evening is there is a draft document that's available for the community and stakeholders to review and comment on. And so tonight we're going to give you an overview of the process that led up to that and then give you a little drive through of the actual document so you get a sense of what's in it and how you can provide comments back to us. So let's talk about the housing element. So if you're not familiar with the housing element, it's one of the chapters or the sections of the city's general plan. And that general plan is the overarching policy document for the city. So it provides direction setting policies, programs, and actions for a period, in this case, an 8-year planning period, 2021 to 2029. And really what it does as a plan, as a policy plan, is it assesses existing housing issues, opportunities, challenges, etc. Not just for today and the needs of today's population, but as we project and look into the future. So it identifies the growth needs of the community and the plans, programs, and actions to help us to address those in the future. So if you think of the general plan, it really is its foundation, a policy of actions. It is a statement of goals, objectives, and actions for the next 8 years for the city of Fontana. And so why do we update them? Well, if you think of the plan itself, it's setting the direction of policy. So every action, every issue, opportunity that addresses housing in the future will take guidance from this general plan housing element update. So if you think of the housing element is that overarching policy document that provides direction for all future actions related to housing in the community. And what's important now is there's a lot of new laws and regulations and what we like to call the alphabet soup of assembly bills and Senate bills that relate to the housing element update. And so the city is obligated by law to comply with all these new statutory requirements. So the housing element essentially creates a framework to illustrate or to show that the city can comply with all the new legislation. And there's almost 70 odd new laws that came out in just the last few years related to housing and the housing element. What happens when the city has a element that is deemed quote unquote certified by the state is it opens the door of opportunities for future grants and funding opportunities. For example, the recent legislative actions have indicated a large sum of money that will be available to local governments to provide for housing opportunities. This is one way that you become eligible for that, to have a certified or a legally compliant housing element for California. But most importantly, the process really is, it allows you and the community and stakeholders to further engage in the planning process. One of the biggest challenges in creating policies is understanding the needs of the community. And you as a representatives of community and stakeholders provide an important link for the city to understand and direct policy to address the needs of the community which they serve. So you see here on the screen, if you heard early, Vitanian talked about RENA allocations. And what that stands for is a regional housing needs assessment. And essentially what that is a projection of growth need over the planning period, in this case, 2021 to 2029, of the number of housing units or new development housing units that need to be accommodated to satisfy the growth needs in the community. So if we look at the screen here and you look at the left side, it says income categories. There's four basic income categories that we see, from very low, low, moderate, and above moderate. And what is that is based on is the median family income for the county which the city is in, in this case San Bernardino County. And that median family income can change every year. About this time every year, that median family income may be adjusted according to economic conditions, among other things. And so is based on that income category, is based on the percentage of median family income. For example, very low income is up to 50% of the median family income. In this case, for 2020, $75,300. That can change every year, as I've said. But for the very low income, you see in the far right of the screen what the projected need for housing units for the next 8 years will be in the community. In this case, it's 5,109 units. And you can see each of those income categories are different sections or components of all of the residents within the community that need to have this growth accommodated. So if we add all those income categories together, it comes to approximately 17,519 units. And what does that mean? That means the city must provide the opportunity, the zoning, the policies to accommodate the 17,519 units. What that doesn't mean is the city must build those. The city is not a developer, the city is a facilitator. So it's the city's opportunity and obligation to provide the requisite zoning policies, programs, and other regulatory and policy relief to provide for the opportunity to build those 17,519 units over the planning period. So we've worked since last year, basically, to outreach to the community. And if you may have not visited the city's Housing Element website, you see here on the bottom of your screen, the link to that. It's easily found on the city's main page if you go and visit fontana.org. The first workshop that was held in approximately fall of last year, it was a presentation and in a back and forth with the community and participation. We reviewed the background of the Housing Element, overview of the RENA process as we just talked about, the project timeline, and provided an opportunity for a back and forth with community Q&A. That is recorded. You can see the link on the right of the screen where you can go to the website. You see a link there on the bottom left, and you can get all of that information there, including the documents, the video of the workshop. If you didn't have a chance to watch it, we encourage you to go in there and see what happened and see the input that the community provided during that workshop. In addition to that, there was a community survey that was provided in Spanish and English. The city launched an online survey to gather that input. It was up on the website from basically the beginning of October until the end of November of last year. There was about 360 responses that we had, and a lot of good data points, a lot of information about strategies, priority rankings, where we should be focusing our attention of policy, among other things. All of that information is available to you online, so you can review that for your information purposes. And then subsequent to that, we had most recently a City Council and Planning Commission joint study session. The City Council members and the Planning Commissioners reviewed the past work that was done, the community feedback, some of the draft documents, and provided feedback initially that would influence and provide direction to the staff on developing policies and programs for the Housing Element. Some of that feedback talked about housing opportunities, how to deal with the unhoused population or homeless population in the community, how to meet the city's goals, and creating a document that really reflects the needs of the Fontana community. Again, that web that is recorded and it's on the website, the city's website, for your review and a knowledge base for you as well. So where are we today? We have a draft, a public review draft that's available. It was uploaded to the city's website on May 19th, so that was late last week. The public review draft includes all the components of the Housing Element. And so if you think of this as a draft that's inclusive of the entirety of the element, it's pretty much there today. It has an introduction, a community and demographic profile, and we'll talk about these in a little detail here in a minute. Analysis of constraints and resources, a plan of action or a housing plan for the 8-year planning period. We review what we've done in the past and make an assessment of our existing and past policies. And then we provide a summary and an assessment of the community engagement as part of the process. So as far as the public review draft, how do you get it and how do you review it? You can see here in the link on the screen, fontana.org housing element. You'll be able to download the public review draft. It's broken down into different sections, so it's an ease of download. So if you have a slower internet connection, it will be easier for you to download that. You can see the link down at the bottom of the screen there. It says public review draft. If you click on that, you can see there's a number of sections that you can review that are PDF files. You're more than welcome to click on those and save them, download them, or read them on your computer screen, whatever is your pleasure. So what's contained in the section here for the housing element? We wanted to give you a little walkthrough of the document itself so you can understand all the component pieces to the plan. The first part is the demographic profile, and that profile essentially is a community profile that analyzes the population, demographic, and trends within the community. It looks at special needs groups, such as seniors, students, person with developmental or self-care or mobility limitations, the unhoused persons or homeless persons within the community, single parent households, which have challenges, and farm workers within the community. All of those bullet points that I just mentioned are required analysis by the state of California as required by state law. So each one of those groups has particular special needs that may influence the type and extent of housing in the community. So we do a special analysis for those individual groups. We look at household income and the economics of the community, jobs, among other things that influence the ability to access and pay for housing, and either rental or for sale. We look at the existing housing unit stock, which is the conditions of existing housing units, the extent and availability of different types of housing for the community as well. Section 3 also provides an analysis of housing constraints. Housing constraints and fair housing analysis are important aspects of this housing element for the sixth cycle that we're working on today. The housing constraints analysis looks at a few things. It looks at non-governmental constraints or barriers to housing. Those are things such as interest rates, access to lending, and other things out of the control, if you will, of the city that influences housing, construction costs, costs to build, costs to get the materials, or things that are constraints or potential barriers to housing. Governmental constraints are things such as city policies, programs, fees, or other things that may have a demonstrated impact to the feasibility or the ability to construct housing in the community. There's also one thing that is new for this cycle. It's related to the extent of fair housing analysis. And we talk about the term affirmatively furthering fair housing. And that's a requirement now that is part of the housing elements throughout California. And really what we have to do in the process is look at the ability for every individual of every means within the community to provide fair and equitable access to funding, access to essential resources related to housing, transportation, and mobility, and evaluates discriminations or opportunities to discriminate in issues related to fair housing within the community. And we are obligated by the law to provide policies and programs that will address and minimize or reduce that to non-existence. We also have to look at housing resources in the community, what things we have to provide for opportunities. And that could be how much affordable housing stock we have in the community. What are the funding resources that we have available for us? What are some of the programs and services and other agencies' assistance that we can access to provide opportunities for our local population? And then what is the land resources that we have to accommodate growth in the future? whether it be vacant land or refill or infill or redevelopment of existing land. These are opportunities that we have to look in the future to accommodate that future land use growth. And finally, if you think of the foundation of the plan itself, the foundation of the housing element is really the policy plan. This is the aspirational component of the plan. It expresses the vision, values, and direction that the city wants to take, and the specific policies and programs that the city wants to use in addressing these needs. So if you think of about a plan in itself, it considers all of the past discussion that we've had with the community, the council, planning commission, stakeholders, survey respondents, and you folks that are on the call today. It forms a foundation of creating this policy, which is programs, goals, objectives that address opportunities and needs for the whole spectrum of incomes within the community, how the community can access or provide access to affordable housing opportunities, what is the needs for transitional, supportive, and other service organizations as part of the housing element update. And then finally, housing for special needs group that we mentioned here earlier, and those who have special or specific needs that need some level of assistance to provide fair and equitable housing in the community. So what are the goals and policies? Really, they are broad guidelines. They're aspirational in many respects, but what's unique about the housing element is they're very specific actions that the city must take. So these policy tools that we say that are there to promote the development and accessibility to housing for all spectrum of incomes within the community. So if we think of everybody, every means within the community as far as affordability and desire to access housing, policies and programs address all of those needs. But the policies and programs aren't just alone in its own silo. They relate to long-term planning and the general plan, such as land use, transportation, infrastructure, among other things. So we have to pay particular attention to its relationship with other things, not just housing related, but relate directly to and influence the ability for the city to provide fair and equitable housing that works well within the community. So the housing element programs reflect the analysis that we've done that you see in the sections of the documents that I described. It reflects the availability of land and resources, financial among others, and then the constraints that you have in the community. It's a means to mitigate those constraints through policy. And so the policy program includes actions, specific timeframes and funding sources, who is responsible to do that, and where that money is going to come from. And that's important because essentially the plan is a plan of actions that has some responsibility to provide the implementation for that in the near future. So if you think of policies and programs, the state has some requirements. And you see here on the screen the little buckets. These are the silos or the different areas that the state of California requires every city and county to evaluate in their housing element. And they are briefly review the programs and policies that you had to learn the lessons. Sometimes things have done well, sometimes not so well. What are the lessons that we learned from that, and how do we change policy accordingly? How do we identify and remove constraints or mitigate the constraints to housing development in the community? And how do we assist in the development of housing through policies, programs, funding, among other things? Identification of adequate sites to accommodate growth. We have to look at places where we can build and create housing opportunity in the community. And then how do we improve and conserve our existing housing stock? It's just not about growth in the future. It's also preserving what we have today. And so the quality of our neighborhoods and the existing housing stock is an important aspect. Some units have affordability covenants that provide opportunities for persons with lesser means to provide housing opportunity. And in some cases, those covenants will expire in the near future. And we provide policies and programs to help to preserve those, to keep those as affordable over the course of the planning period and into the future. And then finally, providing equal housing opportunities for all members of the public. So by any means or opportunities, there's equal opportunity to provide housing in the community. And so what's interesting is, how do we address those in the plan? And we just wanted to give you a brief summary overview of the housing element policy plan. And each of these, and I'll go back on the screen here, you can see these buckets are developed within the policy of the existing Fontana housing element that you can download and review. Is the first goal is to provide adequate housing to meet the needs of all Fontana residents. And there's a variety of programs and actions that create the development of that housing goal. The second one is to create a high standard of quality of the existing affordable housing stock. So we have a quality of standard within the housing stock, and what are the things as far as design, environmental stewardship, among other things, and well-designed living environments that we create for community. And the third is housing development that is not affected by governmental constraints. So we want to create housing opportunity that is incentivized, that is provided the opportunity for investment within the community, not just for one income level, but for all income levels within the community. Policies that look at solutions that reduce those governmental constraints, provide incentives or other reductions in the need for people to go through these hoops of approvals to bring housing to the market. And then finally, affirmatively furthering fair housing in Fontana, enhancing opportunities for affordable housing for all segments of Fontana's population, enforce laws related to discrimination and building financing, et cetera, of housing that is based on race, ethnicity, ancestry, among other things. And we want to partner with local organizations to increase and promote fair housing, outreach and education, and be proactive in providing the means for the public to gain knowledge and provide them with the resources that promote and support the services for providing for fair housing throughout the city of Fontana. So with that, that was kind of a summary overview of the plan itself. We wanted to come back with you today, and we wanted to give you an opportunity to discuss with us. I don't know if a number of you have been able to review the housing element that is on the plan, but we certainly encourage you to do that, and don't expect us to expect from you this evening to have all the answers in front of us of your questions. You still have time to do that. The review period is ongoing, but we wanted to reserve some time for you to provide some answers to your questions. If you have feedback or initial thoughts, are there any topics or issues within the plan that you would like to see further explored or discussed, or you feel was not discussed in enough detail, we saved some time for you this evening for you to answer some of those questions for us as part of the plan. So we wanted to give the opportunity for you as a group to come off and come off the your mute and provide an opportunity to voice your thoughts or ideas. Just so you know, you can also use, I believe, I don't know if the chat function is functioning, but we may be able to use the chat function on the screen there. You can see that there is a little chat box there at the bottom of the screen. And if you have some questions or comments, feel free to also put that in the chat. And looks like Molly's back and she'll monitor the chat for you. But we wanted to go ahead and open it up to the public to provide some comments. And it looks like we do have a taker in Ms. Ana Gonzalez. So if you're ready to unmute, you have the floor. And then just don't forget to lower your hand once you've talked. You have the floor, Hannah.
Thank you so much, Dave, and City of Fontana staff, community members. So my name is Anna Gonzalez. I wanted to introduce myself. I'm representing the Center for Community Action and Environmental Justice. And we're actually working with other, with a coalition of other groups that are monitoring the cities when it comes to their housing element. I'm also a resident of Rialto. So Fontana, you guys are my neighbors. So obviously I do care about this whole issue as well. My question is, and I did put it on the chat, that I would like community to see maybe the maps of the housing, the zoning that's available for housing, so we can interact and make comments or recommendations. I know the city of Riverside and the city of Jurupa Valley recently posted their maps, and forgive my ignorance, maybe you guys have posted it on the city website. I haven't really taken a look, but what I really love about that is that community was able to see where those where the land was that was available for housing, and community members were able to make recommendations, whether they wanted single family units or multi-use or whatever their desire was. And I think that would be a good interactive way for community members to voice their opinions. Also, with the housing element, is there any way we can secure that that zoning for that land that's designated for housing? Because as we're seeing lately, a lot of the residential zoning is being rezoned for industrial to allow a massive influx of warehousing, especially in Fontana. So how can, within the housing element, can we put in a policy in place that will secure that land for from future rezoning?
Anna, thank you so much for sharing. I think I shared a whiteboard. I do want to make sure that everyone can see it now. Just kind of jotting down some of your comments and your questions. To quickly address your first comment, the public review draft actually has those maps available on the city's webpage right now. So if you did want to go through section three, if you download section three, you'll be able to take a look at the maps that the city identified for future housing opportunity. In general, the city zoning map is also available, where you can take a look at where residential is permitted and different types of residential. And then if you go ahead and use that Microsoft Forms that we set up, it's also just a link on the city's webpage, and we can actually send that link in the chat as well. You can submit your comments and any questions that you have regarding maybe those areas for opportunity for housing. And then kind of to address the second half of the question, talking about you know, residential areas potentially being rezoned for industrial or other uses. There's actually new state law that requires cities to, you know, it's considered no net loss, so reallocate or re-identify land for residential if it has been zoned to a lower density, so permitting less housing units, or if it has been zoned to permit something other than residential. So the city is familiar with this process. And if there are areas that are being rezoned for industrial, it's being made up for in different parts of the city where it's being identified for residential and then being rezoned to permit residential in a different area. Daitanian, I don't know if there's anything that you want to add to that as well.
No, I agree with everything you said. And I was chatting back and forth with Anna. So yeah, if you wanted to look at our zoning map, that's on our webpage as well, Anna. And I would encourage you to look at our draft housing element. It has a list and a map that shows all the properties that we're looking at upzoning. And feel free to give us any comments on that. This is the opportunity to do that. In regards to, you know, any properties that we're looking at changing the zoning as part of SB 330, we do have to identify, you know, other properties to meet that loss of density. So but yeah, feel free to reach out to me. I think we've talked a couple of times before. So yeah, feel free to reach out to me in the future if you have any questions, you know, regarding the housing element update, and I'll be glad to help you with that.
And just really quickly, sorry, Dave, I did send the housing element update link in the chat. So that's where you can download the draft document, and you can also provide your comments in that survey just below those documents.
Looks like Michael McGinnis, you have your hand up. You feel free to come off mute and The floor is yours.
Good evening, city staff and other residents. I just want to make sure as we're doing our due diligence in building these housing, I know we need some low income and we're getting some, you know, condos put in. I want to make sure the public safety side of thing is taken care of. The big thing I've noticed with, you know, Duncan Canyon and Citrus, it's 250 units with one way in and one way out. If there's an emergency, that makes me nervous as a retired firefighter paramedic. I've been to many scenes where they have emergency egress, but it's not well taken care of. And the city of Fontana pioneered sprinklers in the residential housing back in the early 2000s. They're one of the first cities to make that part of the city law. I would just like to see a better plan with public safety built into it. You even take Heritage. Heritage, for public safety standpoint, it takes 10 minutes to get to a house in Heritage just with the circles you have to drive to get to them. And I want to make sure, you know, that those residents, you know, 260 condos, you figure two people, two cars per condo, that's 500 cars that are going to try to have to get out in case of an emergency of some sort with fire engines coming in with only one way out. And if the emergency exits work, you know, we'll have more, but how often do those get taken care of? I'd like to see us pioneer and keep public safety a priority in our city. And I know PD has a thing where they don't like to have many entrances and exits in case something happens for a suspect or something, but there has to be a good give and take.
So those are good comments. And, you know, typically when our projects come through, we do take a close look at that. And I'm very familiar with the project you're speaking about. And we have our police department and fire department that take a close look at that to ensure that there is safety. But good comment. And I see that Molly's added it to the notes here. So good comment.
Yeah, I was actually at the city council meeting that night that got approved.
Oh.
Voiced my comment on it, because as a firefighter, paramedic, retired, I've been to many scenes where we're fighting to get in, where people are fighting to get out, and it delays the response. And, you know, minutes count in an emergency. And it would just be nice. You can drive through Rancho right now and see the emergency exits they built for some of their places, and they're overgrown. The gates are rusted. You could tell they're not being open. They're not being well maintained. That's my ultimate fear here is, you know, we get to that point. And so thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael.
And thank you for your service. Do we have any other? Alejandra, looks like you have your hand up. You have the floor if you'd like to come off mute.
Thank you. Good evening. My question is in regards, it's more of a comment. I know that you guys have mentioned right now the no net loss, that the city needs to abide by. So if they rezone a particular land, they can't lose that residential area. So they need to make up for it in another part of the city. My concern is that I actually live in the southern part of the city, and we've been seeing a lot of our land, empty lots, rezoned to light industrial. So I feel like there's a discrepancy there, because all we are getting now in our area is warehouses. So I feel that creates, I want my community to be diverse. So I still want housing in our area, because that's gonna attract other things like grocery stores and restaurants. If all we are getting are these warehouses because this land continues to be rezoned, I feel that we are not getting what we need as a community. I have young children, and I want my kids to live in a place where they get other things other than warehouses. I don't want to be driving to other parts of other cities or North Fontana that takes me more than 30, 40 minutes to get there in order to do the things I want to do in my community. So I feel that the city needs to work better on their planning, and we need to look deeper in this in what's going on with all the zone changes. If the, you know, the specific plan, the general plan is designated an area to be residential, the city needs to work harder to keep that as residential, because in my view, it is not appropriate for all the new housing to be in other parts of the city rather than here with us. Like for certain parts of the city not to get any residential areas anymore. There, in my view, it really needs to be looked at. I feel like it's a big problem. Like I said, I am not an expert in any of this, but I've been learning a lot because I've been noticing how this is happening. And I, before this, I didn't know how any of this worked. So I've been doing my research, I've been asking, and it just makes no sense to me that it is so easy for the city to rezone all this land and we get nothing other than warehouses. Like warehouses are fine. We have a lot of them and that's okay. They're creating jobs and that's fine. But there needs to come a point when we can work with developers and do incentives so they could build something else in our community as well. So that's a big concern of mine. As a resident of Fontana with three young children, that looks forward to living in this area for a long time. Thank you.
Thank you for your comment.
Thank you for sharing.
And then it's Cece or Ceci. I can't see. You can correct my pronunciation. You can come off mute. It looks like your hand is raised. It's Ceci.
She may be muted.
Yeah, it looks like if you're sharing, you're muted. So go ahead and come off mute.
Can we unmute them? We'll send you a signal.
You can only ask to unmute. Yeah.
Let me see if that works. And if you are having trouble, you can always go in the chat and
yes,
make a comment, but we'll have to count to it as a high five for all of us for at this point, unless you come off mute. All right. Do we have any other comments or
anything? I see that she said that she can't unmute. I guess she's trying.
All right, we'll be patient with you.
Yeah, we can give it another minute or so.
There. Hmm. While we're waiting for potential unmuting, does anybody else have a comment or a question that you would like to provide? Just raise your hand if you'd like to, and or you can actually just type in the chat. If you're a little shy, we'll read that to the group. Be happy to that. And Ceci, if you want to type your questions, we certainly can read it to you out loud, or your comment, we can certainly do that. It doesn't look like you're coming off mute here.
Hello?
Yes.
Oh, there you are.
We can hear you.
I don't know what happened, but somehow I'm back. With the previous, resident of South Fontana, I'm also in South Fontana. I would agree with what she's saying. There was a residential area that now is turning into warehouses. And like she says, we are getting inundated with warehouses. You guys, I don't want to say you guys, but the city, you know, is making residential. You guys are making residential areas, but they're not on the south side. You guys are zoning us like warehouses or commercial, but you guys are making residential on the other side of North Fontana. I believe there's North Fontana where there's new houses being built, but South Fontana, there's no new housing or new even restaurants, even to have to go to a restaurant, we have to drive to North Fontana or we have to go to another city. So yes, you guys are building new things in the area. You guys are building new houses, but South Fontana right now, it feels like all you guys, all what the city is concerned on building warehouses. Yes, we do understand that they are zoned for warehouses or commercial. I'm not sure the correct term, but there were some residential areas that are now becoming warehouses. And like the previous resident said, I'm not very aware, you know, of zoning and all these laws and procedures, but I am aware, you know, that we are becoming in the south side commercial. That's all we're getting. And yes, you guys are building houses, but you guys are not building houses or restaurants or shopping centers. You know, I know you guys are building a park, but gosh, that park took, I don't know how many years to build over here on the south side, and it's not even done yet. So yes, you know, the city is making houses and it's great, but I feel like the south area, we're becoming a warehouse. I mean, everywhere that we go, there's new warehouse being built. Jurupa Hills High School is in between warehouses. It's going to be between warehouses. And that's kind of unfortunate that the high school is being surrounded by warehouses. And I know a new one's going to be built in the corner of Slover and Citrus, I believe. So I don't know, again, about zoning, but I don't know if maybe there was something else to put there. I don't know what else. Like I said, I'm not very familiar with all these rules and regulations, but here on the south side, we are running out of places to go. We have to go to other cities to do things. It's just, you know, I just wanted to second what the previous resident said about South Fontana.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for sharing.
And Molly, looks like Liz Senna is on. Has your hand up? You can come off mute.
Yes.
It should be on the bottom left of your screen. There
yes. You go. Good evening, afternoon, evening. Yeah.
Okay. Whatever you want it to be.
You know, this is my first time attending this type of workshop. I'm really glad that it's open to the public and that it's accessible for us to be able to participate. Housing is a big deal for us. I know that we've lost a lot of land during the rezoning process. And so not only did we lose that land for residential purposes, but with that, in a sense, we also lost additional commercial the possibility for commercial amenities. And so, you know, it kind of goes hand in hand. As far as I've been informed, you kind of need housing and people to input into an algorithm in order to produce more amenities and for it to be favorable for commercial to come in and invest. And so without that, we can't really quite get to the next level that South Fontana really needs to be, and that is to have more amenities for the community. I understood that there was a potential for there was a possibility that the city missed the RHNA last go around. So I kind of wanted to make sure that the city is participating and all of the resources available to be able to, get whatever resources that we need to make sure that we're growing as a city, not just a particular area, but also, as a whole. I would love to see for the entire city to thrive. And right now, I have to say that South Fontana is not feeling that. The residents down here, we're not feeling that. We're feeling very isolated in a sense. I don't know how much time I have, but I'll make it quick. and so anyways, thank you for this workshop. I really hope that we can grow as an entire city and thrive, because, you know, right now it's just looking like North Fontana is getting all of the amenities and
South Fontana is desperately in need in a lot of that. So thank you so much for allowing me to speak.
Thank you, Liz.
Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you. I wanted to say something real quick, and I appreciate everyone's comments. And this is a workshop for the housing element update, and it affects the entire city. I really appreciate everyone's comments. And just to clarify and to provide some more background information, as part of the housing element update, we are looking at upzoning, certain parcels, in the city in order to increase the density. I don't know how many of you were able to listen earlier in the presentation. And those of you that have joined late, just so you know, the PowerPoint presentation and the entire presentation will be on our House Element webpage. I encourage you to go listen to it because Dave kind of went through the entire PowerPoint in detail. I think that'll be helpful. But as part of this, as I was mentioning, we're looking at upzoning certain properties, not only in North Fontana, downtown area, but also south of the 10 freeway to increase the potential housing. So the state is really encouraging cities to, provide more housing. Our number is about 17,000 units. So we have to have the necessary zoning for a developer to come in and build those units. So that's really the intent of it. In regards to the industrial, I know there's been a lot of comments in that regards. And just so you know, in a lot of cases, there's properties that are in the city and there's existing residential. Doesn't necessarily mean that that property is zoned residential. And I think we had mentioned about SB 330. Anytime the city is looking at, taking forward a project that has existing residential, we do have to upzone other properties in the city to offset that loss of density. So just want to make those clarifications. But in regards to the house element, there's properties not only in North Fontana, downtown, but also south of the 10 that we're looking at upzoning. So it's entirely citywide. I think there's about 54 properties that we're looking at upzoning, and that's detailed in the housing element, the draft. So I encourage you to take a look at that. But thank you, everyone, for your comments. Just wanted to make sure I kind of gave that background information.
Thank you, D'Artagnan. Kareem, it looks like you have the floor. So if you want to come off mute.
Yes, thank you. Good evening, everyone. Kareem Gongora here. I am a longtime Fontana resident. Used to serve on the Planning Commission. So thank you, D'Artagnan, for that brief explanation. Part of my concerns with the housing element is a discussion with density. And overall, my issue is that when we consider density, we look at what parts of the community that it belongs, right? A lot of the discussions are transportation based. However, what we're seeing is a lack thereof of density near transportation hubs. And so I would really like to see this plan and this element really center moderate and low income and more affordable options. I think with our last housing element, we saw that we didn't meet our RENA numbers. And a part of that, I think, is we're prioritizing the more higher income housing as opposed to looking at more incentive-based projects that we could use as a basis to invite more development into our community, and even looking at infill development as our path forward to look at how we provide more diversity in housing. We saw this in North Fontana when we went from attached to detached condos, right? And there was a bit of pushback on the density there. However, I think we really have to understand that we are a big community, very diverse. We have elderly who want to downsize. We have young folks who want to get into a home. And so I just hope with this plan that we set something very realistic and something also that's ambitious, for the simple fact that we know throughout the state of California, there's a housing crisis. So I thank you for the opportunity to speak. Would love to provide more in depth, and I'll probably follow up via email. But I think the biggest concern for me is the environmental justice element, where you have density near warehousing. And I don't think that's something that's a positive growth model. And I think if we're thinking smart growth, we need to look at how we prioritize communities of color and frontline communities that bear the brunt, and how we can look at landscaping and other elements to kind of mitigate those emission impacts. So thank you for the opportunity to speak, and thank you for this presentation today.
Thank you for sharing. And I see that you have your hand up, So go ahead, you have the floor, you can come off mute.
I'm sorry, did you call my name?
Yes, I saw that you have your hand up. Did you have it
up? Awesome. So Kareem also reminded me right now about the EJ element. I know there's new laws being placed in the state that require all housing elements to have an EJ element attached to it. So one of my questions is, where are we at on that EJ element? And of course, CCAJ can provide resources and some recommendations and support when creating that EJ element for the housing element. And then of course, you know, I did type it on the chat that we understand the upzoning. However, we see that with these, and I understand this is just for the housing element. However, it intersects with the warehousing issue that's happening in Fontana. And I want to reiterate that because it is affecting this community greatly. And with that, you know, we are placing warehousing literally behind people's backyards. And so we want to make sure not only do we meet the RENA numbers within the housing element, but that we address the EJ element in regards to putting warehousing that is polluting these homes and bringing more traffic and safety concerns or safety hazards actually when trucks are driving through residential areas. So not only do we want to meet the RENA numbers, but we want to create a safe and healthy environment for our communities to have a high quality of life. And so I want to make sure that we're also addressing the EJ element within the housing element.
And I don't know if I can provide some background if staff doesn't have any comments.
You go ahead, Dave.
Yeah, so environmental justice elements are required when two or more elements are adopted. So it's a subsequent action that the city is going to take in the short term, but it's not a component of the housing element update to this point. Although there are environmental justice issues related to fair housing and firmly furthering fair housing that have some connectivity with that. But the environmental justice element can be developed in two ways, throughout the general plan or its own standalone element. And that's to be determined by the city. So it will be a subsequent action, but it's to be a required action in the near future, and this is city intent to pursue that in short order. We don't have an official timeline of when that will be, but it will be imminent when that update is to occur. All right. You see any additional comments on the chat or on the Kareem and raise his hand once more. Go ahead.
Yeah, sorry about that. This is my last hand raised. But per the general plan, there is an environmental justice working group that is embedded into that EJ plan. And so I think if there's a group that's created like that, it'd be a good opportunity to engage the community and have those very honest and real conversations about how you incorporate EJ into a housing element. And kind of how we could plan our community as one and move forward together and unify, right? I think a lot of the conversations that I've heard is that North Fontana gets all the nice stuff, Core and Central doesn't. And so I think there's a real conversation we could have about how we could make that conversation much more positive. But that's my opinion. And so thank you for the opportunity to speak again.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We have another hand up. Liz, you can go ahead and come off mute.
So again, I'm new to this and I realize that we have more than one chance to talk. Usually I'm just limited to one time, 3 minutes only. So I'll go ahead and provide a little bit more input too, since I can. I just wanted to say too, you know, again, advocating for South Fontana, I know we're gonna sound like a broken record, but you know, we have some really amazing people down here and so for that reason, I really want to advocate for them and say that our community is very particular in that we have very limited resources. And so even with the shopping center, even with the shopping centers that are here, or, you know, the limited amount of property or
land that is left available. I think it's important to really get a lot of the community input and continue to make more of these workshops available so that we can really prioritize the amenities that we need. For example, I know in the past we've talked about, you know, getting more gyms and fitness centers. And, you know, there comes a point where it's like, well, okay, well, we have one and we really have to utilize what we have already. But where are some of the things that we don't have? And some of the things that would fall under that would be, you know, sit down restaurants or particular shopping, grocery stores. And even in food is a big deal. We're kind of like a food desert. We don't have anything that we can pick up on the way home. So my point in all this is just that I think that if more of these workshops are available to the community, you'd really be able to get, you know, some polling or some type of to figure out what it is that the people down here really need because of the limitations that we have. So even in terms of the housing, for example, if there's conversations that would include, you know, how you're going to structure, you know, the homes, or if they're going to be attached or detached. I mean, a lot of these homes now, they were meant for single homes, and based on economic status, they're now multi-family homes living in a single family home. And that does pose a lot of issues with traffic, parking, you know, a lot of different things. So just wanted to give a little bit of insight on that too. Thank you.
Thank you, Liz. We're taking notes, as you can see, just for those who are participating, we want to make sure we can provide a history of that. And so what you see on the screen is the notes that we're taking. And so this will be part of the record in consideration, and the community, as well as council and commission, all of those will see these comments for their consideration. So we do thank you for those comments. Any other comments that you see, Molly?
Nothing in the chat, and I don't see any more hands raised.
All right. You did a fine job. We got plenty of notes on the screen there. And did you, Molly, want to talk about the schedule?
I do. I would love to. Let me pull up the presentation.
I can do that if you like.
You know what? I think I actually have it ready to go. So I'm good. Thanks, though, Dave. All right. Can I just get a thumbs up my screen? Great. Okay, so we want to talk about next steps. So I'll go back one slide. So thank you so much again for participating. As Dave had mentioned, we are taking dutiful notes. This workshop is being recorded, as Zaitanyan mentioned, and will be available if you missed any portion of it on the city's website. So moving into next steps, the project is following the timeline that you see on the screen here. So if we go back a little bit, what we've already kind of done in this update process is had our first community workshop back in the fall. I know Dave talked about that. We launched a community survey where we got a lot of community participation and some really great feedback from the community, which has been incorporated into this housing element update. We had a study session with some decision makers in the city, so with the city council and the planning commission. I got some great feedback from your city decision makers as well. So where we're at now is we've launched a public review draft. So I know that Dave walked through this earlier. There is a draft of the housing element that's available on the city's webpage. And as you can see, and obviously you are very aware of, you are in community workshop number two. So both community workshop number two and the draft document are just additional opportunities for you to engage in this process, for you to let us know your feedback as you have tonight, tell us your thoughts and your ideas. And as we move forward, we will take into consideration your feedback. We'll work with the state to move towards adopting a certified housing element in the fall. So I really quickly, again, want to go over instructions on how you can download the public review draft. I put the link to the city's housing element update webpage in the chat. So that if you scroll up to the top of the chat, I can send it again. That should be available there for you. It should take you directly to this website. You can also just type in fontana.org /housing element. That should take you there as well. If you scroll down just a bit, you'll find the public review draft header. And then just below that, we've uploaded the document in individual sections. So I know Dave kind of gave you a high level overview and walked through what's contained in each of those sections. So there's the demographic profile, our constraints, our analysis of constraints to housing and barriers to fair housing. We take a look at housing resources and opportunities for housing in the city, and then develop a housing plan using both community feedback and participation and all those individual analyses pulled together. So very important that you take some time and take a look at the document. You know, you don't have to go through the whole thing. You're more than invited to and welcome to do so. And they are available for you there. And with that, what we'd like you to do is take a little bit more time and give us your feedback and your thoughts. We hope to make this as accessible as possible. So I'm sorry, I'll actually go back really quickly. If you see on the bottom of the screen here, just below where you can download those draft documents, you can click this link, which will take you to an online survey or basically an online form. You can tell us just a little tidbit about yourself and then go ahead and type in your thoughts and your ideas or your feedback so far on that draft document. You can submit this. This information is anonymous and it will go directly to city staff. So we'd love for you to utilize this resource. I did send the link directly to this online form in the chat as well. So I can resend both the link to the Housing Element webpage and this form. But please, yeah, download the document, take a look at it and utilize this resource to tell us your feedback. And then one last way that you can submit comments, you can send them to city staff. So we have the phone numbers and the emails for our planners who are dutifully and diligently working to update the housing element for Fontana. So you can utilize that form that will go directly to staff, but you can also send an email as well. Or if you have any follow-up questions, please reach out. We'd love to continue to engage you and continue the participation throughout the process as we move towards adopting a certified housing element. And with that, that concludes formally our workshop. Detain, and I'll pass it back to you if you want to provide a closing statement.
Yes, thank you very much, Molly and Dave, and great job on the presentation. And thank you everyone for all your comments. As you saw, Molly was taking notes, and please, I encourage you to go to our website and take a look at the draft and take the survey. Any comments will be, very appreciated. You know, as we go through this process, the public review draft is going to be available for at least 30 days. So want to get your feedback on that as we move forward. This is a very important project for the city. And thank you all very much. And as always, you can still reach out to me or Cecily or Fernando if you guys have questions in the future. And we're always here to answer your questions. And with that, if we have no other hands raised, we're going to go ahead and conclude the workshop. And a copy of the PowerPoint along with the video of the workshop will be on our webpage. Give us a day or so to upload that. So hopefully sometime tomorrow, all that information will be uploaded to our webpage.